Topping the New York Times bestseller list.
The Shack is in the top 40 bestsellers of all history.
Having sold millions of copies since its release in 2007, the novel The Shack has become a publishing phenomenon. Now a feature film based on the influential book is to be released in March of 2017. What theology does the book teach? Should faithful Christians be concerned at its impact on the church? Documentary filmmaker Paul Flynn of Megiddo Films has released his latest work, The Shack, Its Dangerous Theology and Error, in an attempt to answer these questions. To watch this film free of charge, please visit our website at megiddofilms.org. That's megiddofilms.org.
You're listening to Megiddo Radio. Megiddo Radio is a radio ministry of Megiddo Media. For more, visit our website at megiddoradio.com. That's megiddoradio.com.
Good everybody, welcome. This is Paul Flynn with Megiddo Radio for the 11th of April 2017. Thank you for tuning in on tonight's show. We're going to be talking about homosexual marriage, or so-called gay marriage, the Roman Catholic Church, and also the Jesuits. And, well, we'll see how much we get through today. I've got a clip to play in a second by a man by the name of Robert Barron. Now, Robert Barron got quite popular a number of years ago on a Roman Catholic TV program called Word on Fire a number of years ago. His YouTube channel was quite big. About 2015, I think it was, but midway through 2015, he was made an auxiliary bishop of Los Angeles. And I was kind of aware of him. I try to watch clips from different points of view and didn't, to be honest, look, he's a very well-spoken. You can tell he's kind of an intellect. He's kind of studied a wide range of different things. And he was on the Rubin Report. The Rubin Report is hosted by Dave Rubin. Dave Rubin, who used to be a number of years ago on the Young Turks Network. And Dave Rubin has kind of become a bit of a champion for free speech in the last couple of years, even appearing on a Prager University video called Why I Left the Left. And it's actually quite a good video. For a long time, I didn't know that Dave Rubin was actually a homosexual. I didn't have a clue. Actually, I watched a number of his interviews of various different people. I knew he was a bit of a leftist, but he was liberal in what liberals would claim to be, as opposed to what it has become now, which is totalitarianism. And if you do not agree with their diversity, they clamp down on you and try to use the arm of the state in order to enforce it, as can be seen in different countries around the world. Now, I kind of stumbled upon this, and I'm not going to go through all of it. So this is an interview between Dave Rubin. Dave Rubin of the Rubin Report interviewed, and Dave Rubin has all sorts of guests on from all different points of view. And it's kind of one of the reasons I every now and again watch some of the interviews, sometimes watch some of them, don't watch all of them. And I found it curious because I've never seen a religious leader on the Rubin Report before, curious to what he'd say. So I listened to quite a bit of it, but then I found things that, shall we say, didn't exactly line up with the Bible. And this is why I'm going to critique some of this on the program today. For those who may have stumbled upon the show and have no clue what the show is about, I am a Reformed Presbyterian. I hold to the Bible is the Word of God. That is my ultimate authority, not the opinions of men, not the traditions of men, and not even the opinions of fallible church councils. Now, we can use church councils. They can be a blessing, as can creeds be, because we also submit to the Westminster Confession of Faith. But that is a subordinate standard. It is not our ultimate authority. The ultimate authority is the Bible. Okay? So that is my position, and I am thoroughly against Roman Catholicism or the Roman Catholic Church because it preaches a false gospel. It does not teach justification by faith alone. It has numerous other errors that have crept in, a kind of a sacramental system which you are dependent upon in order to be saved. However, there are inaccuracies within its own system and its own adherence, which we'll see in a second. A couple of years ago, Pope Francis picked this man who's quite popular in the media to be an auxiliary bishop of Los Angeles. The archbishop was above him. He's kind of helps out with that in that role. So we're going to go through this, and look, it's so important. I kind of periodically want to deal with this issue. I don't want it just to go away and we just kind of don't think about it anymore, which is a tragic indictment upon our culture that we don't care about marriage anymore. And Dave Rubin, another thing about Dave Rubin you might not be aware, and he's going to say in the clip I'm just going to play in a second, he is also quote-unquote gay married. Now, again, I say quote-unquote, he's not married. Dave Rubin, if you were listening to this, and unlikely chance that you were listening to this or watching this on Megiddo TV, you're not married. Not, look, what is marriage? Marriage is what the Bible, what God has laid down. God instituted marriage. God is the only one who defines what marriage is. And we have it in Genesis chapter 2. Therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother, this is verse 24, and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh. One man, one woman for life. And that has been instituted from the dawn of society. There's no other definition available. And if you change that, it ceases to be marriage. Every picture in the Bible shows that complementary relationship between a man and a woman. Men and women are not the same. They are different. It's been from the very beginning. In verse 23 of Genesis chapter 2, and Adam said, this is now bone of my bones. Let's just talk about Eve. And flesh of my flesh, she should be called woman, for she was taken out of man. So, from the very beginning, you had man and woman, two genders. Now, I don't think Dave Rubin contests with this. He's a very kind of live and let live, and to be honest, he's probably the nicest guy on that wing. So much so, again, he's been on Prager University videos. He's been on many conservative talk shows. He's the kind of guy who's very respectful, which is very unusual from the homosexual LGBT community. It is. You point out a biblical point of view, they'll get angry incredibly fast. Because men hate God's word. Now, again, you can be very cordial towards God's word in a very outward way. There's many examples of this in the scriptures, but inwardly, because you do not turn to the solution and you reject that solution, the Lord Jesus Christ, and do not flee from your sin, but you cling to your sin, you actually show your revulsion for the word of God in another way, not as openly as maybe someone else would, who maybe openly tears up a Bible, or burns the Bible, or does something else, or attacks a Christian or anything like that. But I will say this, he's very cordial. And again, it just shows, anyway, why Christians, we can't unite around the principle of freedom of speech. We need to unite around the scriptures. And what the scriptures say is good and just and right. Not on man and his wisdom. Not where every religion and every thought has equal placing in society. Now, that is the principle the secular society puts forth. It doesn't follow it. What happens is there's always one more dominant than the other. And one will be crushed. in order to satisfy the quote-unquote rights of the other groups. Okay, let's go through this. This is, we're going to be commenting here on gay marriage and some of the comments that Robert Barron, quote-unquote Bishop Barron, makes, and he's the auxiliary bishop of the Archdiocese of Los Angeles.
Okay, so now let's move to the other two examples that you mentioned. So gay marriage.
Yeah.
So I don't know how much Googling you did on me before you got here, but I am gay married. You are in my house right now. I've thoroughly enjoyed talking to you this entire time. Actually, when I was doing research on you, I got to the, you know, gay marriage portion. I stopped reading because I don't know your full opinion, and I did not want to know before we sat down. So now I welcome you to tell me that. And whatever you say, I will continue this conversation in the spirit which I've done it so far.
Right. And I'd say several things. I said this one time. I was in New York.
Okay. Just before he gets into it, what a perfect opportunity to share the gospel with him. To share he is living in sin. This is wrong. And to point towards the Lord Jesus Christ. But the problem is Robert Barron doesn't believe. If he believes Roman Catholic theology, he doesn't believe the biblical gospel by grace. You're not saved by grace. They believe it's a mixture of grace plus works in their form of justification, because they mix up justification and sanctification. And once a person is converted through water baptism, they say, and then it is maintained by through the sacraments, through the church, basically. The church is the ultimate authority here, not the scriptures. Now, they might say that there's the three legs, and before somebody maybe takes a clip of this and tries to debunk it, say, oh, you don't understand Roman Catholicism, and there's the three legs of the stool. You know, there's the magisterium. Sacred scriptures are authority. They'll say that, even says that in the catechism. And then there is church tradition. But the problem is, what happens when they contradict each other, which often happens, and who decides which is which? The magisterium. So the magisterium, or sola ecclesia, as it really is, the church is the ultimate authority, decides how the Bible is interpreted and everything else. So that's effectively what happens. The Bible is thrown out. That is how it plays out in practice. But here's an opportunity, if the man was truly Christian, to share the gospel of grace, to turn from your sins, repent, and believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. The man is clearly lost. What does he say? I'm talking about Dave Rubin's clearly lost. What does Bishop Barron say?
With Cardinal Dolan, actually, and we were talking to reporters, and I said, if the only thing a gay person hears from the Catholic Church is you're intrinsically disordered, we got a very serious problem on our hands.
Yeah, the Bible declares you're, if you want to use his term, intrinsically disordered, or what the Reformed Church has called total depravity. You go many different places. Just quote a few verses from Romans chapter 3. Yes, you were totally depraved. You were in the bondage of iniquity. Romans chapter 3, verse 10, as it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one. And that includes the homosexual and the straight person or anybody else who's outside of Christ and is not believing Christ alone for salvation, trusting in grace alone for salvation, not in their works, lest any man should boast. So there is none righteous, no, not one. There is none that understandeth. There is none that seeketh after God. They are all gone out of the way. So yes, that is the message the church, the true church, preaches. This church, the Church of Rome, does not preach that. Now, it does teach a kind of a, yes, there is an original sin, but is washed away in baptism and things like that. But if the biblical gospel is not preached by an organization that calls itself the Church of Jesus Christ, it is a synagogue of Satan. They call themselves Jews, and let's talk about spiritual Jews in the book of Revelation, chapter 2, verse 9, Revelation chapter 3, verse 9. They cease to be a church. Every church on earth is subject to mixture and error. There's no perfect church on this earth. But a church can so degenerate. The Church of Rome was once a church, but degenerated in the Middle Ages. Back it was had errors coming in around the time of Augustine, before that as well, and it got worse and worse. The church became semi-Pelagian in the Middle Ages. There were breakaway groups who were Christian. Albigensians, the Waldensians, pretty much synonymous with each other. The Lollards in England, who would have been kind of broken away. I think we've got a one size kind of fits all view of church history. Sometimes there can be this parts of the what was called a, what is the Catholic Church was not controlled by the Bishop of Rome in the 9th-10th century. There was parts of the Catholic Church that once believed in the doctrines of grace. There were Augustinian. But, so there's none good, no, not one. Psalm 14. They went to many different places. This is the message of the scriptures. The fool has said in his heart, there is no God. They're all corrupt. They have done abominable works. There's none that doeth good. But he's got a problem with that message.
That's what the message has become. The message of the church to a gay person should be, you are a beloved child of God who's been embraced by the mercy of Jesus Christ and invited to a full share in the divine life. You're
to the gay person. Again, not biblical. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 9. Know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God? Be not deceived, neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor effeminate, nor abusers of themselves with mankind. The Geneva 1599 translation rendered as boogers. Or another way that could be put is sodomites. Or in modern language, homosexuals. Abusers of themselves with mankind. What does it say about them? Shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners shall inherit the kingdom of God. Is there any hope for anybody? Because we've sinned and all fall short of the glory of God. But it says in verse 11, such were some of you. But you are washed, you are sanctified, but you are justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of God. Those who are regenerate no longer walk in their old ways of life. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17, the person who turns to Christ, the person who's regenerated, the person who's born again of the Spirit, born from on high, no longer lives as they once lived. They begin to love the things they once hated. They begin to love the God they once hated. And then they begin to hate the sin that they once loved. If you're a homosexual, you're born again, and you are truly accepted in the Beloved, and you're truly in relationship with Jesus Christ, in union communion with Him, you will begin to hate your homosexuality. I'm not saying that you won't struggle with it, but you will begin to hate it. You won't continue to enjoy it. You won't continue to say that it is a good thing. 2 Corinthians 5:17, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things are passed away, behold, all things have become new. And all things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and has given us the mystery of reconciliation. That is not everybody, that is the elect, who were chosen before the foundation of the world. Those, talks about in Ephesians chapter 1, those who God has shown mercy upon. I think it's Romans chapter 9, verse 16. It talks about, I will have mercy upon whom I will have mercy. It's not of him that willeth or of him that runneth, but it is of God that showeth mercy. So everything depends upon God, not the will of man, but upon God. We are to look to God. But if somebody continues, a thief, a homosexual, a reviler, an idolater, a fornicator, somebody who has sex outside of marriage. They show by their fruits that they do not know God. I'll just go through one more. This is so important. This is barely understood anymore hardly in the evangelical church, never mind that it's been abandoned completely in the Church of Rome for many centuries. I am the true vine, John 15, and my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit is taken away, and every branch that beareth fruit, he purgeth it, that it may bring forth more fruit. Now ye are clean through the word I have spoken unto you. Abide in me, and I in you, as I in the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except ye abide in the vine. No more can ye, except ye abide in me. I am the vine, and ye are the branches. He that abideth in me, and I in him, and the same bringeth forth much fruit. Without me, ye can do nothing. And if the, again, it's like this principle. You plant an apple seed, when the tree grows, it will produce apples. Not oranges, apples. You will know them by their fruits. And a person who continues in a homosexual lifestyle, and a person who is against what God Almighty says about marriage, shows that they are in reject the word of God. They reject God, and they're not accepted in the beloved. They have never repented and never trusted on the Lord Jesus Christ, ever. So that is not the message to the homosexual. The message to the homosexual is, you have sinned, but there's hope in Jesus Christ if you repent of your sins and trust in him and in him alone.
You're a son of God, called to eternal life. There's message one. Now, within that, are there further specifications to be made about anyone's moral life? I mean, my moral life needs a lot of work, trust me, you know? And I need to hear a lot of challenge from the church. But
we'll do confession at the
end. Afterwards, we'll have a good conversation about that.
Yeah.
No, but the first thing that a gay person, like any person, should hear is, you're a beloved child of God. And so I agree with those, and Pope Francis has been good on this, that have said, if that's the way our message was coming out, we were disordered. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. We had a problem there in the way that message was being conveyed.
So it's a fundamental problem with the gospel. Fundamental problem with the gospel. And you might say, oh, well, this is not Pope Francis and all this kind of stuff. Pope Francis chose this man. Well, at least that's what Robert Barron said a number of years ago. And now, we whenever we come up with issues like this, and with comparing the scriptures with the Roman Catholic Church, okay, I'm not doing what I normally do, and if you go on, and I purposely just want to focus on Robert Barron, what Robert Barron says in this interview, and how it's not biblical, but normally in other shows, and if you want to check out other shows, I've spent time going through the Catholic Catechism, the Council of Trent, official documents of the Roman Catholic Church. The Roman Catholic Church does not teach the Bible and the Catholic Catechism. They do not match. And you have a choice. Do you believe the scriptures, or do you believe this institution that says it is the only true church?
What's the church's take? That sexuality has a structure, an intelligibility that's built into it, if you will, by God, and is discernible within our physical, psychological, and spiritual makeup. It's got a proper end and purpose. The church would say it's for intimacy and for procreation. Therefore, that's the fully integrated, properly expressed form of sexuality. When we fall short of that, I say we on purpose. I mean, we all in different ways, I think, fall short of that ideal, including married people. The church says no to that. In a certain way, I don't want to press it.
The church says no to what?
Says no to whatever that imperfection is, whatever that failure fully to integrate the meaning of sexuality. And see, in a certain way, I wouldn't want to press it further than that.
I know, because it might be a bit unpopular. Anyway, there's another problem here with this kind of been the downgrading of the sin of homosexuality and gay marriage, which is kind of what the question was really about, and he mentions about that. Let's get this in perspective. Sodom and Gomorrah were destroyed. Why? What was practiced there? Is there, in the scriptures, is there any good reference to homosexuals? No. It is seen as evil, vile. It is seen as one of the worst things that can be done. God rain fire and brimstone upon Sodom and Gomorrah. God praised in times when the kings of Israel removed the Sodomites out of the land. What else does it say? Because we're just kind of going, yeah, well, we don't want to press any more than that. Oh, well, you know, it's... This is something that wasn't even legal in this country where I live, the Republic of Ireland, in the early 1990s. And in most countries. It is only... Homosexuality has been only legal for a couple of decades in most of the Western world. Yes, all sin deserves death. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ. Yes, of course. But there are some sins that are worse than others and more heinous than others that are against nature, as it says in Romans chapter 1. Let's go to Romans chapter 1. So, talks about creation, Romans chapter 1, verse 20. Talks about having their heart darkened, it became fools, verse 22. Verse 25, who changed the truth of God into a lie and worshipped and served the creature more than the Creator, who's blessed forevermore. Amen. For this cause God gave them up to vile affections, just because their hardness of heart. For even their women did change the natural use of that which is against nature. And likewise also the men leaving the natural use of the woman, burning in their lust one toward another, man with man, working that which is unseemly, receiving unto themselves that recompense of error which was met. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not convenient. So what does God call them? Vile affections. I don't want to press it any further. Vile affections. And there's not one place in the scriptures that just kind of go, well, you know. No, we're supposed to, if any of us claim to be Christians, take sin seriously. But Rome changes the bar as it suits her. And likes to change and contextualize and all this kind of stuff. And move depending where it's living. You'll get people in different parts of the world. And will emphasize different things. Liberation theology in Central America. More liberal in places like California. More bigoted in Italy. Rome is like a chameleon. If you go to different countries where Roman Catholicism has destroyed and impoverished, you'll see Rome as a chameleon. Let's continue.
That's the church's job, is to say no to what it perceives to be an inadequate, incomplete integration of the sexual act. So, not just gay marriage, but now go across the board. Anything that falls short of that ideal, the church would say no to. Why? Because it's down on people, it's puritanical, it hates sex. No, it's keeping its bar high and calling people always to that bar. As we all fall short of it, the church offers at its best the lavish mercy of God. I mean, so that's sort of the context I try to set for that conversation.
Right. So I understand the church's bar on this.
Yeah.
I'm not part of the church. It's fine for the church to have that bar. I have no problem with that. So your personal feelings on this matter. So gay marriage was passed, what is it, a year and a half ago or so?
Yeah.
Almost 2 years now. Did you, I assume you felt it was the wrong decision by the court.
Pretty simple one. It's a wrong decision and it needs to be changed. Why? Because you are doing something, well, unprecedented in human history, but also you are just attacking God's institution there since before the fall of man. It's an attack upon God. It's God's institution. If you change marriage, and this is the Marsha Gieson, who is LGBT, she's both Russian and American. I played a clip on, it was a couple of years ago, and I was talking about this. I played a clip for her talking about this, about how she says that it's a lie that marriage won't change. Marriage will change. And she also said two things, that marriage should change and also the institution of marriage shouldn't exist. And I think, her children have like five parents and all this kind of stuff. What? Because they want to make up the family after their own image. Actually, really just destroy the family. What is the fundamental truths of Scripture being attacked everywhere on the left? God created them male and female, two genders, pretty clear. Science agrees too, by the way. And no. Apparently, depends who you talk to. There's five genders. There's 31 genders. There's 1,000 genders. Oh, who knows? Whatever number you want to make up in your head. Whatever kind of mental disorder you have in your brain. You can believe whatever you want. Apparently, it's separated from biological sex. Supported by, nothing. So, but you see a pattern here. God created male and female? No. People don't want that. Their foolish heart is darkened. And then just returning back to so-called gay marriage. It's not marriage. Dave Rubin is not married. Their foolish heart was darkened. And once you redefine marriage, it destroys the institution of marriage, which is openly what some LGBT activists want to do. I'm not saying this is what Dave Rubin is setting out to do at all. I don't know. I don't know the man. He seems very cordial. He seems like one of the leftist programs that you could actually go on if you were on the other side. As long as, you know, there's no cursing on it or anything like that. You know, sometimes people in Christian media will sometimes go on programs. I don't have a problem with that. If you'd have to pray about it. Like, for example, I wouldn't touch CNN or I wouldn't touch BBC because they just do hit pieces and they edit you out of, you know, you take segments out of place and all this kind of stuff. And they're proven liars, much of the mainstream media. You know, BBC and CNN, just for two examples. And CNN are some of the worst. But if you're allowed to speak and there was no cursing, and I say that as well because I've seen not great, and I'll be honest, these are they're not great. Much of the internet, to be honest, look, much of the internet, by way of podcasting, especially for Christians, is awful. You'd be much better off. Honestly, I'm not going to plug a lot of podcasts. Most of them are rubbish, I'm sorry. Most of them are theologically poor. They're people who have, sometimes aren't even in churches at times. You don't know them. This is the problem with the internet. It gives a voice to people who shouldn't really have a voice and doesn't prepare people properly before that they go into public and start teaching and make it look like they might actually know what they're talking about. Like, to be honest, when I fell into it years ago, when I started the program and things like that, I've said this a number of times, I would have been better off to held off for a while. I'm not saying that you have to be ready to be a pastor to have a podcast. That's not what I'm saying at all. But if you're going to have a Christian podcast, one of the things I would recommend to people, make sure you're in a church and just a good standing and make sure you're just a faithful member. That's all I'm looking for. I'm not looking for, like, it's a podcast. It's not the same as preaching. But I digress. Oh, yeah, what was my original point? And I kind of went off on a bit of a tangent. But don't go on programs where there's swearing on it and foul language. And I know there's not a lot of you out there, maybe just some. That'd be two of my rules would be this: is God being glorified? Can I share the truth in the gospel, or is it gonna be pearls before swine? Some programs it is. As long as you can get the gospel out, there's no cursing or swearing, foul language, things like that, and they're not complete, manipulators. They don't have to be perfect. They don't have to be even conservative. Like, I'll be honest, Dave Rubin is the kind of program I would go on. I'm not trying to angle myself towards getting on his program or anything like that. To be honest, I have never been on. In the last couple of years, there's only one program I've been on, and that's Chris Arnson's. Actually, I'll be on Chris Arnson's program tonight, and I don't know when this program is going to actually go on McGitterRadio.com. Probably before this, but it's 5 to 6 Eastern Standard Time. And look, I like Chris. He's I don't know him personally, but I've talked to him a good few times. Well, on his program, Iron Sharpens Iron Radio. Very nice guest, great host. A lot of Reformed people like him and have been on his program. And I've listened a few times. I'll be honest, I don't get a ton of time to listen to his programs, but usually they're great. Honestly, whenever I listen, they're great. I don't need the program to be perfect to go on it, but sometimes, I have to pray about it and see if it's wise. And there's a lot of strange stuff on the internet nowadays. Anyway, complete tangent. I'm going to have to get back to this. But is God going to be glorified in this? Getting back to homosexual marriage. Simple question, really, for Robert Barron. There's no such thing as gay marriage, and it should be. There are no gay marriages. There's nothing to. It's fictitious. It's like a round circle. Or a round square, sorry. Doesn't exist. Doesn't exist. So the law immediately needs to be changed, but unfortunately, this is what he says.
Is that fair to say? I don't want to put words in your mouth.
Yeah, no, I do, but I don't think I would want to press it much further. I think where we are right now in the States, I'll apply the Aquinas principle. I think it would probably cause much more problem and dissension and difficulty if we kept pressing it.
So then do you not see gay marriage as one of the ones that you said was so pressing earlier when you said that abortion would be one that is so pressing that it could shift, it could alter the course of a country or something? Do you not see gay marriage at that level of severity?
No, I do think it does have a negative impact on the wider society. I do think it is, in a certain way, a compromising or undermining of an institution that's key to the health of a society.
Can you explain that a little further? Like, how so?
Just as the dignity of the individual is fundamental morally, so I think marriage, we've classically seen as the great building block of the wider society. So all the different forms of social life are grounded finally in that fundamental form of social life. So marriage open to children is that form. And society, I think, takes that as one of its foundational elements. So I do think there's a compromising if we forget the integrity of that that foundation.
Yeah, is this one of the things where I sense that your heart and your spiritual sense self maybe aren't quite matched up? Because I don't sense judgment from you sitting here. I really don't.
Yeah.
And I don't sense that you want that you would try to legislate to reverse the decision. But I also sense that you can't fully say to me, well, it's okay.
Yeah. No, and that's probably right. The way you just put it there is probably right. I wouldn't want to fully just say, that's great, off you go.
Yeah.
At the same time, I wouldn't want to get into a crusader's tank and try to reverse that. And I certainly don't want gay people to have the impression that the church is, in some kind of special warfare against them. It's not. The church is, at its best, is reaching out in love and reaching out with the offer of the divine life. That's what matters. So I feel strongly about that,
Yeah. All right. So
okay. And on condition of the offer to divine life, repent. Repent. Be converted. Repentance means turning from sin. And something as obvious as this in the scriptures needs to be seen. I'm trying to get the verse. If repentance, like, you can't just say, well, special warfare. Hey, yes, there should be. Should we hone in on just one sin and not talk about the other sins? No. But is homosexuality a specifically heinous sin as described in the scriptures? Yes. What does the scriptures command us to do from any and all sin? Repent. Turn from that sin. An about face from it and flee to Christ. That's what the scriptures declare. Now, next part I wanted to deal with was the Jesuits. Arturo Sosa Abascal, and the last time I was talking about the election of the new black pope, that's the nickname of the superior general of the Jesuits, who, he's Venezuelan, he was elected a couple of months ago, can't remember the exact date, I think it was like the end of last year when I covered the program anyway. If you type in the word black pope into MegiddoRadio.com, I'm just going to put in a little, I put in a lot of, probably maybe too many cautions. Studying the Jesuits, don't Google it. Don't. Please don't Google it. You're going to get just crazies and crackpots. I'm sorry. On the internet about this topic. It's one of the worst studied topics at the moment. The church is just engaged in, just in order to fill in the gaps, because the research just hasn't been done in this area, in massive speculation. And because it's gone into speculation, it's kind of large sections, not the whole church, but large sections of the church, professing church, has gone off into massive speculation. So much so that some parts of it even have gone off into, and I'm going to get emails about this, I know it, about flat earth and all this kind of rubbish. Okay? You know, there's a big flat earther movement, which just kind of proves the massive, it's like a drug for people. Leading them, I've seen it time and time again with different people. They're just following conspiracy theories. They're not following the scriptures. And I'm not saying these conspiracies don't exist. They do, of course they do. A conspiracy is simply two people getting together and plan something. Of course it happens. But we can't speculate and theorize endlessly. There are things, conspiracies that have been proven beyond a shadow of a doubt. The gunpowder plot in 1605? With Guy Fawkes. The 5th of November. Remember the 5th of November, the gunpowder treason plot. That's not a theory, that's actual history. The plot of the Pope of Rome to kill Queen Elizabeth, I think it was in 1580. That's in the official records, in the state records, at least it was. Printing of a book by the Protestant Truth Society a number of decades ago. Anyway. Various documents that have been found. And you have to check these documents to make sure they're not forgeries and fakes and everything else, and that the quotations aren't just pulled out of nowhere. Check where they are. Where do they come from? Check that book. Make sure it exists. I always put this in because when I'm dealing with the Jesuits, I want to deal with what they're actually saying. With, look, a document that'd be good. Study, if you want to study the Jesuits, get on PDF form, actually. And I have only gone through parts of it. Constitutions of the Society of Jesus. Now, it's in Latin. Now, the title's in Latin. I cannot speak Latin, but there's a translation at the back of this. You get this on ebook. This is not in print. Because this book, this edition of the Constitutions of the Society of Jesus, it was published in 1838, and you know, it's the Latin verse, and then there's a translation of it later. Documents like that, the spiritual exercises, writings prior to the 20th century. And you might say, well, how about the last 50 years to 100 years? Honestly, it's been so poorly done. If you don't know, then don't speculate. We can, and it takes a long time, and unfortunately, people don't have the patience to piece together what it takes. Brother Lord was asking me about recent guys who've done, you know, have done some good research on the Jesuits. There hasn't really been any. The best that's been done at the moment, Chris Pinto of Adullam Films. I used to be about 5-10 years ago. Was it not even 10 years ago? I would have watched a lot of Chris Pinto's films. Unfortunately, there's kind of a, in some of the recent documentaries he did, even though they're great, in a lot of places they're great, some places where it violates the Second Commandment, which really put images of Christ and representations of Christ, which really ruins how much I can enjoy the movies and things like that. But I digress. I mean, I'm not saying everything he's done is perfect or anything like that. But that's the limitation of it. There's not been much. We can't. I'll just give you an example before we get into the story. And this is, the story's in Breitbart, by the way, that I'm going to be dealing with. And it's a biblical issue. Here's what happens sometimes on the internet. A person will, for example, just say Trump, all of his cabinet, say 60% of them are Jesuit trained. Just say. Now, I'm not saying that it's true, by the way. I'm just picking that just purely as an example, just before anybody quotes me on that. That's not what I'm saying. But just say that's true. There's a couple of possibilities with that. It might mean something, it might mean nothing. Here's the problem. People don't want to entertain the second one. It might mean nothing. Just say 60% are, hey, maybe, see, it's cheaper to go to a Jesuit college usually. They usually make it cheaper, usually because they want to get the next generation and they want to form so that they're going towards Catholic ideas, Roman Catholic ideas, without even really knowing it. That's been written before in various histories in the past, and shape the future. Roman Catholics, when they built, you know, in the 16th century onwards, they built these big, massive universities because they wanted to get the next generation. Prior to that, they weren't really interested in training many people because it was quite different. They wanted to keep the populace in ignorance. But then again, just somebody's Jesuit trained, it might mean something, it might mean nothing. Lots of people have been Jesuit trained and are fundamentally against what the Jesuits stand for. We can't speculate and we should not go beyond what the evidence teaches. That's all I'm going to say. Seriously, I mean, whenever I deal with this issue, you get, oh, it's been linked to this, linked to this. What's there? It's all speculation. Sometimes we just have to say, and I'm going in a bit of a rant here, I don't know. I don't know how this connects to this. You don't have to know. If you can prove it, great. And I mean prove it beyond a shadow of a doubt. Anyway. So let's get, there's two stories. One from a couple of days ago, actually, written by Dr. Susan Berry for Breitbart.com. And there's also another story that I found a couple of months ago in February of this year. Thomas D. Williams, again of Breitbart as well. The two headlines read as follows. Jesuit superior, Jesus was not, quote, black and white on man-woman marriage. And that's the one that caught my attention. Showing the kind of relativism and how they morph and change with the times. And remember, Pope Francis, Jorge Bergoglio, is a Jesuit. Now, Jesuit Superior Council General, this is the older story from February, which was written a couple of days after the interview that they're referring to. We don't know what Jesus really said. So there are the two articles. Now, I'm going to focus on the actual interview itself. Breitbart wrote two stories on it. But for the sake of time, we've only got about maybe another 10, 20 minutes left in the program. The Roman Catholic Church might present itself that has never changed. It does. And you might say, well, that's just the Jesuits. Remember, again, Pope Francis is himself a Jesuit. And you have to ask yourself, who is really in control? Is the Black Pope really in control of the Vatican? Does Jorge Bergoglio, who is a lower-level Jesuit, who has sworn, and it says in the constitutions, this is why I say go to the original documents, to submit to his superior. It says in, this is in the constitutions of the Jesuits, the sixth part, chapter one, in paragraph one, it says, and let everyone persuade himself that they who live under obedience shall permit themselves to be moved and directed under divine providence by their superiors as if they were a corpse, which allows itself to be moved and handled in any way or as a staff of an old man, which serves him wherever and in whatever thing he who holds it in his hand pleases to use it. Thus obedience he should execute anything on which the superior chooses to employ him. Now, the reason I bring this up is a number of historians about 100 years ago said, or they believed, that the Black Pope was really in control of the Vatican. That, and again, I'm just stating what they said. I don't know. I'm still studying through this. That they had control of the Vatican by that point. Now we have a point where now you have Jorge Bergoglio and his superior in the Jesuits is the Black Pope, who in this, so who is a corpse to who? What happens in such a situation? The 10th rule, this is at the end of the spiritual exercises of Ignatius of Loyola. We ought to be moved. We ought to be more prompt to find good and praise in all the constitutions and recommendations as the ways of our superiors. That's the 10th rule. That's not reading all of it. The 13th rule says to be right in everything. We ought always to hold that the white which I see is black if the hierarchical church so decides it. So the church decides it. And that's who you have in the Vatican at the moment. Who apparently, when he speaks ex cathedra on matters of faith and practice, then he is infallible, apparently. What a blasphemous claim. Only God is infallible. And divine inspiration has been finished with the close of the canon of Scripture. Where are the signs and wonders to show that the canon, that divine inspiration, that the God is speaking here? There is none. It is just chaos and confusion. Arturo Souza Abasco, who I talked about in his election a couple of months ago, did an interview with a blog called Rossoporpora for the Giornale del Popolo of Lugano. Now, Lugano is in the south of Switzerland. It is the Italian-speaking part of Switzerland. So there's different regions in Switzerland and they speak different languages, the different cantons and things like that. And he was interviewed by Giuseppe Rosconi for this blog. Now, the original is in Italian. There is a translation available at lifesitenews.com. And the original interview was on February the 18th. Now, the question that Arturo Sousa Basco was asked was, and this is the question that Giuseppe Rosconi asked. Cardinal Gerald L. Mueller, prefect of the Congregation of the Doctrine of the Faith, has said with regard to marriage that the words of Jesus are very clear. And no power in heaven and earth, and neither an angel, nor the Pope, nor a council, nor a law of the bishops, has the faculty to modify them. All right, so he's asking, okay, you know, so it's unchangeable. So Arturo Sousa Basquel says, so then, this is the Black Pope saying, so then there would have to be a lot of reflection on what Jesus really said. At that time, no one had a recorder to take down his words. Notice how he said that. At that time, no one had a recorder to take down his words. What is known is that the words of Jesus must be contextualized. Sounds a lot like a modern liberal or somebody in the emerging church. And that's why there's such affinity with them in Rome. What is known is that the words of Jesus must be contextualized. They are expressed in a language, in a special setting. They are addressed to someone in particular. The interviewer says, but if all the words of Jesus must be examined and brought back to their historical context, they do not have an absolute value. And he's right. What does Abascal say? The Superior General of the Jesuits. Over the last century in the church, there has been great blossoming of studies that seek to understand exactly what Jesus meant to say. Meant to say? How about, here's the word of God, and let's compare scripture with scripture. We have everything we need. All scripture, 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16 and 17, all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. Scripture is sufficient. We don't need extra biblical, historical context. Compare scripture with scripture. How do you interpret one part of scripture? Another part of scripture interprets it. He says this is not relativism, but attests that the word is relative. Talk about sophistry and casuistry. Anyway, you know, arguing both ways, and that's the way a Jesuit will tell you, genuinely argue and talk. They'll talk both sides, so they'll say, and Pope Francis is like this as well. He'll talk one way, then another way, so whatever way you can pick one of his quotes and say, oh, he's really saying this, and the opposite side will say, I is saying the opposite. This is not relativism, but a test of the word is relative. The gospel is written by human beings and accepted by the church and made up of human persons. Again, sounds like a lot like a liberal says that this is not the word of God. It's just, oh, it's written by human beings. So it is true that no one can change the word of Jesus, but one must know what it was. So he's really saying, so it is true that nobody can change the word of Jesus, but one must know what it was. Well, we have it. Genesis. It's not just the red letters, by the way, in the New Testament. It's all, every word is written by the Holy Spirit, using men, of course. Apostolgraph of Theonustus in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. Holy men moved. Holy men spake as were moved by the Holy Ghost. That's inspiration. This is the word of Christ. It's quite clear from his comments now, marriage is relative, anything's relative. And it, you know, it's not relativism, but the word is relative. It's like, oh, well. So another part later in the interview, I'm not going to read all of it. So he says at the end of an interview, and this is the question he was asked. So if conscience after the sermon tells me that I can receive communion, even if the norm does not provide it for it. This is Abascal's answer, the Superior General of the Jesuits. The church has developed over the centuries. It is not a piece of reinforced concrete. It was born, it has learned, It has changed. So much for the claim that Rome has really never changed. But anyway, this is why the ecumenical councils are held, to try to bring the developments of doctrine into focus. Doctrine is a word that I don't like very much, but it brings with it the image of the hardness of stone. Instead, the human reality is much more nuanced. It is never black or white. It is in continual development. And look, this whole black and white subjectivism is also very similar to what was put forward by the novel The Shack by the author William Paul Young, by the emerging church. Human reality is much more nuanced. It is never black and white, says Abascal. So it's not black and white. So very much, the word is relative. And he says, but we must know what... So it really, if you're saying such a thing, you cannot say that we really know what Jesus actually said. And this is where the rubber hits the road. When it comes to Rome's view of the scriptures, especially the Jesuits' view of the scriptures, but Rome's view of the scriptures, they have a Jesuit in the Vatican. Now, are we going to have a case where Pope Francis condemns his superior in the Jesuits? Is that going to happen? Or will Rome change its definition of marriage? And to be honest, there's been certain people are suggesting that they may go that direction. It's not black and white. We don't really know. Oh, we're fully developing. We had less of an understanding of it back then, but now we have a better understanding of it. We have to contextualize it. And this is in response to the question which said, regard to marriage, that the words of Jesus are very clear. For the Jesuits, and it would seem by also the current Pope, because of this, because he's a subordinate in the Jesuits to the Black Pope, and if you look at, compared to other organizations, look, there is a slavish, blind obedience that is called for in the Jesuits. And I'm sure, look, there's going to be Roman Catholics who will disagree with that and say that's wrong. And who is your final authority? Is it the scriptures? And the scriptures are crystal clear on marriage and various other issues. And once a church rejects the gospel, or rejects the teaching of scripture, very plain teaching of scripture, do not be surprised when it also rejects its teachings on marriage. This has been Paul Flynn. May God bless you all.